Gradient Maps. Gradient Maps are the light of my life. Gradient Maps spark joy. Gradient Maps lessen the crushing weight of existence in this dire world, and you too can benefit from Gradient Maps by watching this tutorial. Hi, my name's Toffel and I'm your lovely host for this video. But I didn't create this tutorial alone. I made it together with Ezra. You can find both our social media link below. As I've already hinted at, our topic is gradient maps. What they are, how they work, how to use them, and how to create custom gradients. Gradient maps are an extremely versatile tool. So even in this tutorial, we only scratch the surface of what's possible. We made this tutorial for Clip Studio Paint's Tips of the Month contest with a theme color correction, so there's also a text version linked in the description. Now, without further ado, let's dive right into it. But before we can actually talk about gradient maps, we first need to clarify what a correction layer is and why they are so useful. Correction layers. First off, what is a correction layer anyway? To put it simply, a correction layer applies a certain effect to all layers below it. What exactly it does depends on the kind of correction layer you choose. And the great thing about them is that they are non-destructive. That means you can reverse the effect or edit its settings at any time. You can create a correction layer by right-clicking the layer palette, then in the context menu there will be 9 options to choose from under New Correction Layer. For almost all correction layers, a dialog box with customizable settings will pop up, which we'll just ignore for now. The correction layer itself on the palette will look something like this. Where you would usually see the contents of a layer as a completely gray box, with a small icon in the corner. The icon indicates which type of correction layer it is. For every new correction layer, a mask is automatically created as well. You can double-click the gray box at any time later on to adjust the settings, which will open the same dialog box you've seen when creating the layer. Next up, what can all those different correction layers do? Here's a short summary. First, brightness contrast. As the name suggests, this effect is able to change both brightness and contrast of the image. Hue, saturation, luminosity can adjust, well, you guessed it, the hue, saturation, and luminosity. The posterization effect reduces the amount of colors in an image to a set number. Reverse gradient inverts all colors. This is also the only effect that doesn't have further settings. The tone curve effect adjusts the image's RGB channels using control points on a graph. Level correction is very similar to tone curve, but it uses sliders on a histogram instead. Color balance lets you adjust the balance of each RGB color, and binarization turns all colors in the image pure black or pure white. But all these correction layers pale in comparison to the magnificence of gradient maps. Gradient maps are probably the most complex of these 9 and, more importantly, my favorite. Which is why we decided to make an entire tutorial dedicated to this correction layer. A gradient map is a simple yet versatile tool to change the colors of an image, for both grayscale and colored images. Just like any other correction layer, you can create a gradient map layer by right-clicking the layer palette, clicking New Correction Layer, and then Gradient Map. After doing that, the following window will pop up. At the top, you see the color bar, which displays the gradient that will be applied to the canvas. At the bottom left, there's more gradients to choose from. Double-click any gradient to copy it to the color bar. This group of gradients is called a gradient set. To access other gradient sets, click the name of the current gradient set. This will open a drop-down menu of any gradient sets that were pre-installed, that you created yourself, or that you've previously downloaded. For the following example, we've selected the sunset purple gradient from the pre-installed sky gradient set. If you simply hit OK without changing any further settings, it will have the following effect on the image. The effect will be different if we change the correction layer's blend mode or opacity, which we'll explain further in later sections. Basically, the gradient map correction layer reads the grayscale value, that is, how dark or light the color is, of each pixel on the image. Then, each pixel will be assigned a new color in accordance to the gradient. Pure white areas will change to the color to the very right of a gradient, whereas pure black will become the color to the very left. A mid-range color will change to a color along the middle of a gradient, and so forth. Most gradients you will come across range from a dark color on the left side to a light color on the right, but that's in no way all that is possible for gradient maps. For example, gradients don't necessarily need to have any smooth transitions. They don't need to transition from dark to light, and can have as many or few colors as you wish. Basics of editing and creating gradient maps. Under the color bar are several small arrows. These nodes each define a specific color, and can be moved to different positions. The colors in between notes are created by mixing their colors. To create a new note, click any empty spot on the gradient. Clicking the garbage can icon to the bottom right will delete the currently selected note. We have specified color, you can change the color of a selected note. The rectangle underneath shows the current color, clicking it will open a color selector. And this next bit is important, so listen up. Any changes you make to the color bar are not automatically saved to the gradient set. To save a gradient to a set, you need to use one of these two buttons. This button on the very left will override the highlighted gradient in the set. And this one with a plus icon will save the color bar as a new gradient. The garbage can icon deletes the highlighted gradient. Now, if you've accidentally overwritten or deleted a gradient you didn't mean to, fear not. If you click cancel instead of OK, all changes made will be reversed. That includes all changes you've made since you opened the gradient map window, so keep that in mind. The last area of the interface we haven't mentioned yet is the mixing rate curve. The mixing rate curve of each node determines how its color mixes with the color of the next node to the right. To edit the graph, you can move the existing control points or click anywhere on the curve to create new ones. To delete a control point, drag it away from the graph. This right here is the default mixing rate curve. When the mixing rate curve checkbox isn't ticked, it behaves the same as this default curve. As you can see, this graph isn't perfectly linear. That means the gradient between the two nodes isn't perfectly smooth. To create a linear gradation, drag the two middle control points away from the graph to delete them. On the other hand, a curve like this will result in a direct transition from one color to the next without any color mixing in between. For this specific example, creating an S-curve similar to the default curve results in more very dark grays and very light grays, and less grays in the mid-tone range. A reverse S-curve, on the other hand, creates more mid-tone grays and less grays that are very dark or very light. You could also go back and forth between the left and right color several times. If you click the wrench icon, you will not only find options to create a gradient set, you can also change the name of a set or of a single gradient. Next up, we'll show you some ways to actually use gradient maps. Of course, there's many more possibilities, but personally, I use these four methods the most. First up, colorizing grayscale artwork. We've already shown many examples of gradient maps, simply added on top of the image without any other adjustments. That's an easy way to add a pop of color to your art and add some interest. But you can also take it one step further and add local colors as well. Here I add an overlay folder and paint some colors on top. Keep in mind though, that colors and overlay don't show up on pure white, so you might need to change your paper color to more of a mid-tone gray. At the beginning, I chose the soft sepia gradient from my own set, which created a very warm lighting situation. Switching the gradient to something different can change the atmosphere of the artwork entirely and takes only two clicks. And onto the next method, colorizing line art with opacity. As you can see, the line art in this artwork has varying opacity. In a case like this, a gradient map can quickly add some color. First, create a new folder and move all your line art layers in there. For simplicity's sake, I merged all the lines in this example. Underneath the lines, add another layer filled with solid white. And lastly, add a gradient map layer above the line art, but still in the same folder. The gradient should have pure white at its right end. If that isn't the case, the gradient map will affect not only the line art, but every color underneath as well. Which you could use to your advantage if that's what you're going for, but in this case we want the color layers underneath the line art to be unaffected. The line art should look something like this so far. And for the final step, change the line art folder's blend mode to either multiply or linear burn. With both of these blending modes, white areas become transparent, so the colors underneath will be visible again. One thing you need to keep in mind with this method is that if your flat colors aren't clean enough and the line art is fairly light, the flat color's edges become visible underneath. As long as your line is fairly dark overall, it shouldn't be an issue though. And now for the third method, adjusting contrast with overlay. Gradient maps can also be used to adjust the contrast of a colored image. and unlike a brightness contrast layer, this also harmonizes the colors in the artwork. First, as always, I create a new gradient map layer and set the layer to overlay. Then I go back to switch the gradient. A normal dark to light gradient, as most gradients are, will increase the contrast, whereas a light to dark gradient decreases contrast. You can flip any gradient with this button below the color bar. No matter which one you choose, you will probably need to lower the layer opacity. And the last method we'll show you today, turning images to grayscale. Using a gradient map traction layer is the easiest way to accurately turn an image to grayscale. And accurately is the important word here, because technically it's easier to add a hue saturation lightness layer and turn the saturation to zero. I used to do just that to check the values of my artwork, which is just about the worst way to go about it. Please don't make the same mistakes I made. I won't bother you with all the details as to why that is, but as you can see for yourself, results vary drastically. The version with 0% saturation looks way different than the other two. Especially the yellow turns out a lot darker than it should. As you can see, changing the expression color of a layer looks the same as the gradient map version. But this method requires you to merge everything to a single layer, which makes it more difficult to make changes later on. You can find the drop-down menu for the expression color in the layer property palette. To create a grayscale gradient map like used in the example, you can't just add black on one end and white on the other. The mixing rate curve of a black node needs to be linear. If you leave the mixing rate curve at its default, this will slightly increase the contrast of the image. How to download gradient maps. There's plenty of user-created gradient sets available to download on Clipstudio Assets. For example, this one by yours truly. If you want to get this set, search my username Toffel, that's T-O-F-F-L, and you should find it right away. Next, just press download in the top right corner like you would on any other material. But we are not done yet. If you just go back to Clipstudio Paint and create a gradient map layer, you won't find the gradient set in the list. First, you need to open the material palette, then open the download folder and select the gradient set. Then click this little button at the bottom of the palette. Now if you open a gradient map layer, you can open the downloaded gradient set as well. Process walkthrough. Creating a true-to-value gradient map. I almost exclusively use what I call true-to-value gradients, which basically means that the values before and after applying the gradient map should be the same. In other words, you don't need to worry that the gradients will change the values you've already picked. Now, I'll show you how to make a true-to-value gradient yourself. Step 1. The new gradient should have white at one end and black on the other, which is the default for new gradient map layers anyway. Step 2. Add whatever colors you want the gradient to consist of. That can be as many of hue colors as you like, but keep in mind that the more colors you use, the longer you'll need to finish your gradient. In this case, I added 4 nodes in dark green, indigo, lavender and yellow. The position value of each color node should match the HLS lightness value of the color, for now at least. That way, each color will be at least approximately at the right position to be considered true to value. Step 3. Set the mixing rate curve of every node to linear. To do that, check the mixing rate curve box and drag the two middle control points away from the graph to delete them. And step 4. The last and most difficult step is adjusting the values. To do this, you first need to set up your canvas as follows. First, create a layer with a perfectly smooth black to white gradient. The gradient map you want to edit should be above that. And lastly, at the very top has to be another gradient map layer with a grayscale gradient map. When I switch the new gradient map, not the grayscale one, on and off again, the gradient looks slightly different. To be true to value, the result should look the same, with or without the gradient map in between. So what I do next is move around the gradient's nodes until that is the case. Typically, blues and purples need to be moved closer to the left side, whereas yellows and oranges have to be pushed towards the right side. And that's already the end of our brief digression into the world of gradient maps. We hope this tutorial was helpful in some way or another. Since we only covered some basic methods for applying gradient maps, there are still many more possibilities left for you to explore. As mentioned at the beginning, this tutorial was created by two artists. Ezra edited and animated the video, while I, Toffel, wrote the tutorial and recorded this voiceover. All drawings, animations and videos used in this tutorial were created by one of us, and all gradients used were pre-installed in Clip Studio Paint or created by me. Follow us on Instagram, Twitter or ArtStation to see more of our art and other content.